The Strapped In Auto Racing Show on BCTV is supported by Shirley and Shelley Miller.
Good evening. Welcome to the December edition of Strapped In. I'm your host, Mike Feltenberger, and tonight we're going to have the annual fan forum show. If you have any questions for any members of the panel, we'll be going through everybody's personalities that are involved in racing right after I make a couple of announcements here. Feel free to do so, 610-378-0426. First off, I'd like to congratulate Northeast Dirt Modified driver Stuart Friesen for his fourth place finish in the Truck Series races this season in NASCAR. He's going to be moving from a Chevy to a Toyota in the 2020 season and getting some of his equipment from Kyle Busch. Also, I'd like to make a couple of announcements here. Indoor racing coming up, coming events, January 3rd and 4th up at the PPL Center up at Allentown, PA. They're going to have the TQs, they're going to have the slingshots and the go-karts. Cage kart, slingshots, and TQs up at Allentown PP&L Center January 3rd and 4th. And also, news coming out of the Leesport area, Shellhammer Speedway will be having their Wingless Wednesdays every Wednesday next year from April through September. So come on up. They're making some improvements at the Speedway now. They're putting a new concession stand in, and they're putting new bleachers in for the seating. So Wingless Wednesdays goes weekly at Shellhammers in 2020. We're going to go around and give everybody odds on, or heads up, I should say, on their involvement in racing. And then we got a couple questions to ask. Like I said, home viewer line 610-378-0426. You're up, Mike.
All right, I'm Mike Fitzgerald. I'm a race fan since I was a kid. Spent three years as Brian Chewy's crew chief on the 177 late model that he drove.
Scott Arndt, I became a race fan and spent 14 years racing 250s, 270s, and 28 years racing with my son, quarter midgets all the way up to midgets, and now I'm just back to a race fan.
Jeff Grippley Evans, I grew up at basically going to the Reading Fairgrounds and worked a lot of the local dirt tracks around here.
I'm Mike Knappenberger. I'm a photographer for Area Auto Racing News. Also, the Lankos track photographer. I also came up with the idea for the race chasing awards that are given out weekly at all the small tracks. That's about it. I still consider myself a big fan.
My name's Eric Ambler. Been a race fan just about all my life. Started at the fairgrounds. I became a race official probably about 21 years ago, and I've been working at either Big Diamond for about 8 years. I'm at Grandview now 19 years, and I also was assistant starter for 5 years at the Action Track.
I'm Mike Feltenberger. I've been going to the races since June of 1958.
Wow.
I've been a fan ever since. I've been a photographer, media photographer, since 1971. Started with the Berks County Record, went to the Reading Eagle, Area Auto Racing News, and all the media outlets. I've worked as a official in some sort, in any capacity, one time for a season at 71 different speedways. So I've been an official out and about. I'm going to be the Wingless Wednesday announcer at Shellhammers in 2020. So come on up and listen to me yap over the microphone. And we'll see what happens there. That's our panel for tonight. So if you have any questions, 610-378-0426. My first big question is, do we need a 305, a 358, 360, and a 410 sprint class? Does something have to go?
Yeah. reason why I say that is all the divisions, the car counts are down. And if they start to condense a little bit, of course the car counts are going to get better. They say the 305s are inexpensive, but I don't know. Yeah, they got to do something. Something's got to go.
The thing with the 305s, the cars that run good are probably spending just as much money as the guys that run a 358.
Well, yeah.
So, you know, and they run for the same, from 1st through 24th is all the same, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
The 305, so.
Are 305s crates, Scott?
I know they're iron blocks. I don't know if they're, don't think they're crates, right?
No, they're not a crate motor.
They should put starters in them 305s.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's all I'm going to say.
the bad thing is they started, you know, for all those years you had 410s and they went with 358s because it was a cheaper way for guys to get in. Now, if you want a 358 thrown at the Grove and be competitive, you're going to spend as much money as you spend on a 410 and you're racing for a third of the money.
Yeah.
Same with a 360, same with a 305. It all started out as cheap, but eventually it becomes just as expensive.
But you do need starter divisions.
Yeah, you do. I don't think they all need to go away, but I think it's getting to the point where there's too many of them. You know, you don't want somebody to just hop into a 950 horsepower and 410 and, you know, you need some laps in something.
Yeah, they're going to hurt themselves.
That spring car class at New Egypt is cray motors.
That's building, isn't it? They're getting more and more cars every...
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Okay, this is to you, Mike.
Go ahead.
You're considered a race chaser.
Mm-hmm.
I really need to know, why do you drive 20 hours to see a race that you can see the same class of race cars if you go an hour away?
That's good.
Most of us are competitive, and it's something that you want to do. You want to grow your total, and the only way to grow your total is basically go to new tracks. Now, since I started the race chasing fund, I haven't been doing much track chasing. Race chasing and track chasing, two different things. Race chasing is count your races. Track chasing is count your tracks. So what I did this year is I didn't go to any new tracks because I was stuck at 1099, 1099 racetracks. So what I did is I wanted 1100 to be special. So I waited till they threw the dirt one down in Knoxville.
Yeah.
And I mean, Nashville. And basically, I used that to get my 1,100 different racetrack. Okay. So.
That's cool.
Okay, big news addressed just this weekend. And I know they're 5 hours apart and 300 miles apart. But the Fonda 200 and the 50th Grandview Freedom 76 are the same day. Is that good, bad, does it make any difference? Or I'm figuring, if anything, Grandview might have gotten two or three cars. But
We don't see the dirt guys. I mean, if any of those guys come down, it might be freezing. I mean, we had one year we had...
Alan, Danny freezing, Shepard.
Billy Decker was there.
Yeah.
I don't think it's going to make a difference. Brett Hearn was there. Yeah, I don't think it's going to make a difference.
And it works with Brett's show against Oswego. So, you know, it gives the guys that may not do well at Oswego or, you know, a chance to race that weekend and make some money too. So, Brett made it as, you know, the working man's deal, and it worked for all these years. So I don't see the two.
Has Grandview announced how much they were going to pay for the 50th anniversary?
No, that's going to be a surprise announcement.
That could also weigh out a little thing, you know, because I don't know what the Fonda race is paying, but it that could weigh a little bit too, because I know Kenny told us that they weren't going to go with 50 again, but they weren't going to do 100 like Middletown did.
Yeah.
So is it going to be 75,000? That's what I'm thinking. So we'll see. I think what they do.
I think the guys that aren't regulars there are going to look and see, you know, do I run good at Fonda or do I run good at Grandview when I go there?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's going to sway their decision a little bit too.
Oh, sure.
Especially if they, you know, they're traveling 3-4 hours,
mm-hmm.
you know, something like that one way. I think their past success is going to factor into whether they run those races or not.
I also like to see it because the Grandview guy can win their big event. I mean, they could win anyway, but at least the money's staying at home, you know, to honor the regulars. You know?
Yeah, Craig did that the one year in the traffic jam. He started like 23rd in a small block, and he beat the big blocks.
Yeah.
Okay, now there's Blast from the Past, Garden State Vintage Racers. There's a couple of the vintage racers up in the New York area. Is it good for racing in a way, or does it sort of make racing sort of look like it's, you know, blasé now, because the idea of you're putting a body, a Pinto body or a Vega body on something on a 2005 chassis and calling it a vintage car.
I mean, it is neat to look at the nostalgia, you know, and it brings back a lot of memories. The thing is, if it is an original car and they wreck it, it's like,
yeah.
Not good.
Yeah, because I think one of my buddies, he has one of the, I guess it's one of the original R10s.
Yeah.
And if you wreck any part of that, you're going to, because back then it was, you made your parts. Yeah. Now you buy your parts. Yeah. And it might be a little bit different tune here. Homeview Alliance, 610-378-0426. Mike, you worked on Scott Lee's, Brian Shuey's late model and a couple cars. It's popular, but why isn't late model racing as popular in our area as it is in the South or out in the Midwest? Or
I think because, especially right around here in PA, you're dominated by small block modifieds and sprint cars. Mm-hmm. They're what everybody sees all the time. All the tracks run them. You don't see, other than Port Royal, too many places running super late models on a regular basis. The traveling groups only come here once or twice a year, you know. But when you get down south, they don't have dirt modifieds. They have sprint cars, but not as much as around here.
Right.
So I just think that's, you know, those guys down there grew up racing dirt late models. Guys around here grew up racing midgets, sprint cars, modifieds. And that's, they just keep going.
Yeah, because their modifieds down there, what, UMP and IMCA?
Yeah.
And there's a completely big difference between those modifieds and what we're seeing on a Friday and Saturday night.
Yeah.
Which I thought, they're pretty cool, but I mean, like 9-inch tires is the max. And
Those, if you look at them underneath the body, they're a lot like a late model.
Really?
Yeah, they're basically a late model with a different skin on it and smaller tires. Suspensions are about the same. They set them up similar.
Okay. Now, Kenny Wallace said this. Kenny Schrader said this. And I believe even Kyle Petty might have said this. Are there too many races? It's to the point now where, does the fan want to go on Tuesday or Wednesday or Friday or Saturday or Sunday? And then the regular shows at these racetracks, it's like trying to get people to show up because they already spent their $30 on Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday. Are there too many races?
I'm a fan. I'm going to say no. I mean, I could go racing every goddamn day. No, I'm sorry. Every day. And I just... No, I would go racing every day if I could. So I'd say no.
Mike,
I think there is. I mean that I'll step on my toe because I'll probably be there every day. But at the same time, when you see what's happening to people and they're not getting even to wash their cars and quite a few other things, you know, in their the wife may be staying home because they really don't have the money. I know a lot of people personally that's happening to where, you know, you always saw the whole family there when they were running two nights a week. Now they're running three and, you know, they're picking and choosing. So.
Because it's not even so much as hard being on to the fans as the race teams. Because you got to prepare every time you go out there. If something happens... You know, you're back in the garage, and you know, it's at a point where, I don't know. What do you think, Jeff?
I think, like, the economy is hurting it. I mean, to me, like Eric said, I'd go 7 days a week, you know. But like I said, with the way the economy is today, to take a family of four to the racetrack, you know, and then you buy the sodas and hot dogs and French fries and the program books, it's like it can get expensive.
What do you think, Scott?
I'm like Eric. The fan side, I could go every night.
Yeah.
The car owner side, the preparation. Back when we were running 600s, we ran Wednesday at Kutztown, Friday at Linda's, Saturday at wherever. We just would pick a track. Right. But the time at Thursday night was all night in the shop. And then Saturday morning, Brett and whoever would spend all Saturday morning getting the car ready from Friday night. And then we have off, well, we wash the car Sunday, and we're right back at it Monday and Tuesday to get ready for Wednesday. So to prepare a car, yeah, it's probably too many.
Yeah.
What do you think, Mike?
I got to agree with Scott. You know, as a fan, I could go 7 days a week. But when it comes to working on the cars and stuff, it's a lot. And a lot of the casual fans don't realize the dedication and what it takes to keep a race car on the track. I mean, just to run two nights a week. If you're running the same car two nights a week, you got a lot of work ahead of you. You know, your whole weekend's shot.
Man, it's not like these guys are getting paid. You volunteered. Yeah. You're taking the time to do it out of your own, you know, out of your own time.
Yeah.
I mean, there's some of the big dirt teams that hire. Yeah. But, you know, it gets crazy.
If you have a family at home, mm-hmm. you know, young kids, they might go along with you, they might not. Your wife might want to go, might not. You know, it starts to get expensive, too. You know, if you're a crew member and you're paying your own way into the races, you know, you go just about anywhere you go, you're looking at $30-$35 getting the pits. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now you go 2-3 nights a week, right there you drop the $100 just for yourself. Now you send your kids, 2 or 3 kids and a wife over to the grandstands, you know, you're dropping $200 a night just to go there.
But the nice thing about it is if you look at it, most racetracks, you don't have to pay to park.
Yeah. Yeah.
You go down and see a Philly sports thing. It's $30 to park. Mm-hmm. There, I guess even, $5 and $10 to go see the Reading Royals.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know the parking authority wants to make some money, but $30 just to park is it's a little outrageous. So that's, you know, that's two admissions if you go on a regular night to a racetrack.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, okay, next up. Pocono is having a dual NASCAR weekend. Thursday will be the ARCA race. I believe Friday's the truck race. Saturday will be a Xfinity race and a cup race, and Sunday will be a cup race. Good idea, bad idea? I mean, they got to follow what NASCAR says, but...
Yeah, and I think they're doing it all because of the Olympics and TV coverage.
Right.
So, IndyCar pulls it off. They do it at Detroit, and they run both races in that weekend.
Yeah.
I think they can do it, and...
Well, the nice thing about it is, from what they were saying, every car that's on the lead lap on Saturday gets inverted on Sunday.
That can make it interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so if you're 17th on the lead lap, you're going to start on the pole in the... Do we have the John Kozak sandbag? Or Sorry, John.
Yeah, I think it's going to work. I really do. I mean, when I saw it on the schedule, I was like a little... But yeah, I think it'll work.
But the thing is, are they shoving too much down the people's throats, though?
I want to know what the tickets are going to be.
$100 for the whole weekend.
Yeah. That's
not bad. You can't beat.
That's free camping?
Well, no. I don't know about the free camping, but I think it's $100 for the whole weekend.
That you can't beat. That's not bad.
But for the people that travel around and follow NASCAR, it's definitely a good deal.
Oh, my God.
You know, one tow to one place, get all that
all
racing.
That racing, yeah.
You know, it was just funny, though. They took the IndyCar date away from Pocono. But they have it in Richmond, the same date that the NASCAR weekend's at Pocono. So do you want to drive down to Richmond and see the IndyCar race, or do you want to go to Pocono and see the NASCAR race? Because they're both on the same day. That's a little bit of a coincidence. Mm-hmm. Okay, this is good. On my Facebook, one of my group pages, the Strapped In one, and I also did it on all sprint cars, I posted, and I know we all saw them, a couple of Run What You Brung pictures.
Yeah.
You wish they'd come back?
Yes.
Yeah, definitely.
Yep. Yes.
It's interesting.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, because you just like to see what's going through their head and what they want to put out there and think is going to work.
Well, I remember Willman had that big, long flex
like a billboard.
Yeah. Kenny Breitbo had something like that, too.
Well, the picture that I posted, he had Steve Smith's wing on the roof.
Yeah, I seen that, yeah.
And I noticed that was a dish wing.
Yeah.
It wasn't flat.
I think it wasn't flat.
It was a dish wing. Yeah.
Yep. And Bob McCready showed up with this humongous sprint car wing, and it was just a bare frame modified. And I think he lapped the whole field like twice. I mean, that car was sailing. But yeah, that was unbelievable.
Didn't Grandview have them at the end of the year?
Yeah, that was fantastic.
Yeah,
I used to love them.
Yeah, it was just be fun.
Well, it was funny because Jimmy Horton actually took a sprint car put the side panels of the modified on it, and then put the wing on top. So he had part of a modified, part of a sprint, and you couldn't tech them, but they said, because I was talking to Dave Dissinger, and he said with these Rumwich and Brungs or whatever the case may be, the open competition things, they have rules governing now. So why would you have rules if there's not supposed to be any rules?
Yeah. I think it opens it up to some ingenuity.
Oh my God.
You know, you see, like, a lot of guys will, if they do that with a late model, the whole left side's all plexiglass.
Yeah.
That thing's handled like a freaking slot car.
Then you realize how much beer did they drink in the garage
the night before
when they thought this out.
Yeah. Scott, did any of your classes, did the midgets or the micros or anything, did they have anything like that? Or is it, you run what you came with every?
Yeah.
Okay, there's one. You follow them because you're the Lanco track photographer. Do you think having a Rumwich and Brung micro race would be something of, I think it'd be pretty cool.
I think it would be too. I think especially the hypers out there and Terry Schaefer and all them, I'm sure they'd come up with something really creative, you know, to kind of drum up business. I mean, some of the cars these days anyway, you know, with some of the things that are available, you can make them look pretty cool. Yeah, I would enjoy it, that's for sure, as a fan.
Viewer line 610-378-0426.
There's money to be made. Mike Dicely's coming up with something.
Well, they already have wings and wingless, but there's got to be places they can put things that just...
Oh, yeah.
Because I remember when the sprint cars, like in the mid-70s, all of a sudden they came up with the corn pickers with the sheet metal on the side to keep the back tires down, and it was like... All of a sudden, you went from, you know, 110 miles an hour to 120 miles an hour.
Well, J.J. Yealy had something like the nose piece at Grandview one time, and I guess they made him alter it.
Really?
Yeah.
I remember that.
That was a Night House one.
House won the Wingo show, yeah. I think it was with the CRA show.
CRA.
I remember that.
Now, being that Reading's been closed for 40 years now, and they have the Reading Fairgrounds Racing Historical Society. Would it be nice if we could actually find a place to have a museum somewhere?
You know, me and Daryl Herman have been going to the meetings and stuff, and last week on the way home, we're actually the last generation that really will care about the Reading Fairgrounds at all. Mm-hmm. So, it'd be nice to finally get something, but who's going to really care about it after we're gone?
And is there going to be enough funding to pay for the building and the electricity?
They got a good chunk in their building fund, but it's not near enough for what they need.
Mm-hmm. Well, I always thought with Hoover Motors being out up in Wernersville,
that would be a perfect
spot. You can put the cars that the glass windows in the front. Mm-hmm. It's like that would be the perfect place to have a.
I still would like to see it on the site. Especially with the mall not being anything now until they figure out what they want to do with it. Just have one part of a building and just have it as a museum.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it'd be fitting.
I mean, and to do that, it's going to take help. Like, we go to the meetings and it's the same 15 to 18 people at the meetings. It seems like there's no interest from the outside, but... We're going to a couple shows and Galen's crying for help. He needs help. He can't do it all on his own. There's five or six guys that help him.
Okay. Now, with that being said, you have the Reading Fairgrounds out in Burn Township that runs 1 week. Is there anything, Scott,
there's
could have more races at that racetrack?
There's no races there this year again.
Was it taken off the schedule? That's right, because they were at Shellhammers.
They're going back to Shellhammers. Mm-hmm. Dave's giving the track, to them for that week again.
So what was the reason? Is the reasoning because the fair isn't drawing anybody, or because? Because I know there for a while Mr. Shell was ranting and raving about all the noise and stuff from the racetrack, but if you stood there and listened to it, you heard the Midway guy over the races on the racetrack.
I think it has more to do with the fair board or whoever runs it than Mr. Shell.
Okay. Well, that's not good. Hmm. Okay. Now, with that, they have the Nostalgia National weekend or week at Shellhammers now, and they have the driver is the Hall of Fame there? No, the Hall of Fame isn't there. That's They have a special party for the Hall
of Fame. Yeah, that's in November. That's at Janelle's at the banquet hall, the Hall of Fame dinner.
Okay. So basically what it is, it's the race, and you can mingle with the drivers that are there for shell hammers.
Yeah.
Okay. So, okay, now let's get to this. What constitutes too much racing or too late of a night? I mean, I've been to places where there's no curfew, and they'll keep you there till 2 o'clock in the morning just so they can sell hamburgers and hot dogs and keep the people there. And then you have some racetracks that want the people to be home in their merry way at a decent hour because they know if they keep doing this show, the fans will keep coming back.
Too much racing is a 4 or 5 division show.
Yeah.
Where three divisions have enough cars to qualify, but they still run heats.
Yeah.
Where they don't have enough, they wouldn't have to run heats, they could just run a feature.
Right. Yeah. That's like Grandview does that with their Thunder on the Hill. It's the 25 lap features.
If you remember when we went to Reading, there was time for us to go in the pits.
Yeah.
Now, there's no time to go in the pits at the end of the night.
Yeah, I always thought that for like a two-division show, there is no reason why that two-division show can't be over in 3 hours.
Yeah.
It should be over in 3 hours.
Yeah, when there's a threat of rain and they start and they get over in 3 hours,
why can't they do it regular?
Yeah.
That's true. Yeah.
I mean, you got to look at the circumstances of long red flags. If there's injuries and we got to have ambulance or a helicopter come in, God forbidding that that would ever happen. But you have those circumstances. If there's a power failure, there's that instance. There's a lot of things that change that. But still, there's no reason. I don't care how many cars each division has. Three hours for a two-division show.
Go to a lot of tracks and they'll run. Say they're going to start at 7:30. Okay, they got two, maybe three divisions. They run their hot laps. They run their heats. All their qualifying's done by 8:30, quarter or 9. And you're thinking, I'm going to be out of here at a decent time. We only got two or three features, you know. Before you know it, it's 11:30, quarter or 12, and you're still sitting there waiting for the last class to come on the track.
Yep.
There's something wrong there.
Yeah.
I mean, understand, there's cautions, there's red flags, there's a little bit of track prep involved there, stuff like that. But to drag it out like that, and then they look at the people come through the gate and they say, why isn't anybody coming? You know? Well, most people anymore work 6 and 7 days a week.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They have other stuff they're doing with their families on the weekends. You know, you go to a race on a Friday night or a Saturday night, you don't want to be getting home at 12:30, 1 o'clock in the morning, especially if you got an hour and a half drive or something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, till you get home, it's 2 o'clock. You know, and then you're dragging yourself out of bed the next morning to try and do something with your family, and your day's shot.
Oh, yeah.
And we always talk about we're the last generation of true race fans.
Yeah, yeah.
Half the time when you're there, you'll see a father or a mother carrying the kid out after the heats because they had enough. They had the kids falling asleep.
And, mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know.
So I was saying that with a friend of mine. We were talking a couple years ago how fortunate we were to grow up with the Reading Fairgrounds because that was one of the premier tracks in the country.
Yep.
You know, like even with Reading and maybe Nazareth, Flemington, they were all close to a town where walking distance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, we had guys
coming in walking distance for a teenage kid to.
And we used to have guys coming down from New York. They'd come up from Florida to race there. It's, you don't see that anymore.
No. Mm-hmm. No. And it's to the point now where some of those guys race for a living, but a lot of them didn't. And now you have the guys, there's a few of them that race for a living now, you know, in the area. Jeff Strunk, I believe, is one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a couple others, you know, like Stewie and Matt Shepard and that. But It's sort of back to the point now where it wants to be a hobby, but it can't be a hobby because you're spending so much money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So.
Now I got a question.
Okay.
For you guys. How is the Wednesday night deal going to work between Schellheimer's and Kutztown? What are your thoughts?
Mine? I think there's enough cars and people to go around.
Mm-hmm.
But what I'm also thinking is, and this isn't to take anything away from Kutztown. I was on the starter stand for 6 years. I did the points and did the payouts. But you got guys that have been going, supporting that racetrack for 6 years that qualified for two features. Why would you keep going back? You could go to Shellhammers. You can probably qualify and take some money home with you instead of giving money out every week. So I'm thinking what might happen is when they first start in April, if some of these drivers come in and see, you know, hey, we're taking some money home and doing well, there's a chance that, you know, they might stay and run the rest of the season. But there's enough cars and fans to go around.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think there's enough cars.
But why Wednesday? I mean, if you really want to go during the week, why not Tuesday or Thursday, you know, to run weekly? It worked well with Borgers in Kutztown. Mm-hmm. I mean, I love Shellhammers. I love Action Track, you know, two of my favorite tracks. But even me, you know, now with my deal of race chasing, you know, if they're running both, I'm going to be there and I'm going to support both tracks. Now I got to pick and choose. And is it going to be I go to one week, one the next week? To show my support, or is it going to be in the beginning, go to Shellhammers, then go through the Kutztown season, and then go back to Shellhammers, which that's how it was before, and it worked well for me. I'm just talking for me, but I know that whole top row of the bleachers at Kutztown and at Shellhammers are the same people.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
And them people got to make that same decision, and there's a lot of them, you know, and they would be at both places if they ran different nights.
But I also think, Mike, if you look at it, Kutztown has the curfew.
Yeah.
And a lot of times, some of those poor guys in some of those classes get hosed.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They pay for a pit pass, they come in, they take three hot laps, and you're not racing tonight. So all of a sudden, they spend all this money on pit passes to load up and go home.
It happened to the Slingshots midget when the midgets were there.
Yeah.
They never got the run.
And that's a shame, and probably some of the things that Eric mentioned, you know, the extra red flag and whatever is what caused it.
Yeah.
And maybe both places run too many divisions on a Wednesday night, you know, because we've been to both places pretty late, you know, and or a division get cut out. But, you know, they got to try to make money for the tracks, too, so I understand. And both ownership groups, you know, are friends of mine, and, you know, I think they do what they can do to please everybody, and that's sure as heck hard. You know, I mean, it's hard enough just trying to please us six, you know, but, you know, they got to please a heck of a lot of people. So, you know, I support them both. I understand what they're doing. I'm understanding Wednesday's right in the middle of the week, so it is a good night to run, but I truly think that Shellhammers, you know, and I'm not pointing a finger at Shellhammers because, I mean, from day one, they treated us all well. I mean, media, press, fans, and they grew that thing, and they grew it well. And so I'm very proud of what they did, but at the same time, I think probably next year it might revert back to something else because I think somebody will be forced to do something. That's just my opinion.
Well, it's funny because all of a sudden, like, you know, Action Track was going Sunday. And now all of a sudden they're going Wednesday. So, I mean, who's to say who's right and who's wrong on that situation?
I hear through both ears, I understand.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, we're all gonna have opinions, but so do they, and they know what they need in their hand to keep both places going. And we do need both places
going. What I'm thinking there is, you know, if Shellhammers would have went to Tuesday, the guys are thinking, well, if I crash, I can't run Wednesday. Or if Shellhammers would have went Thursday, if they crash on Wednesday, I can't make Shellhammers on Thursday. So, let it go.
The same thing's going to happen with Kutztown having that rain day.
Yeah.
Because if they rain out Wednesday or get half the show and decide to finish up on Thursday, who's that going to hurt? That's going to hurt Linda's.
Yeah.
It's going to hurt your other Friday night tracks.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the guys are going to go back there. They're not going to be ready for Friday. So, you know, again, it's all our opinions.
Yeah. If one track could run like a Sunday and another a Wednesday, that gives the guys time to get the cars ready. You know, it gives people more racing, too.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, Mike, let's talk about indoor slot car racing. I mean, a lot of people here, the interest, it's people they ask us about it, but they don't know about. You run at what? Heisters
and Randy's
and Little T's and Mark Williams has. We're gonna have Randy's Raceway on in a couple months, but they have that. Was it Burks and Lebanon
Tri-Track series?
So, what's up with this?
I started doing it when I was a kid. You know, I had two older brothers. They were 10 years and 12 years older than me, and they had them. And when I came along, by the time I was 4 or 5 years old and I could play with stuff like that, they didn't have the interest anymore. So it ended up in my room. And I had them. I had every year at Christmas, I got another set, you know, and I just built and built and built and built. And then when I got older and got married and had kids, I gave everything away. And then when my oldest son was like 6 or 7 years old, I was walking through Boscov's and I saw a set sitting there for like $30. I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna buy a set, put it on the basement floor, and we'll have a blast. And now, quite a few years later, it's turned into a little bit more of an obsession than a hobby.
It is fun.
You know, it's a blast.
You know, the funny thing about it is whether you're at Randy's or Heister's, Little T's or whatever, and this is no life, fans. The straightaways are 24 foot long. The turns are 3 foot wide. And we get around in these cars in, what, 2.2 seconds?
Yeah.
Which comes out to a scale speed of like 1,250 miles an hour. So if you don't have a car that you can't see, you're in big trouble.
Yeah.
But it's fun to do. Randy's Raceway is up on Main Street in Kutztown. They run Tuesday nights. They have, what, two tracks? And then they have the road course.
Yeah, yep.
And Heister's HO Raceway is right off of Lancaster Avenue over in Shillington. They run on Thursday nights. And Little T's is...
He runs about every... Not quite every other Saturday. He's up in Myerstown.
Okay.
The Saturday afternoons.
And then Mark Williams, does he have the track or is it...
Not currently. I think he's in the middle of changing houses.
Okay.
So... He doesn't have a place right now, but he will,
okay.
I think, in the near future.
Home your line, 610-378-0426. Here we go. I can't wait to hear this. Jeff Grippley Evans, you were a former WWE wrestler, correct?
WWF.
Sorry. Is there any coexistence or anything racing-related that would join to wrestling? Is there any kind of a mingling with wrestling and racing?
Yeah, the temperament and the driving.
No, really, it's
entertainment. You know, you have your favorites. You know, everybody cheers their favorite. They boo their villain. It's, you know, it's kind of the same thing.
Okay, I'm glad you said that. Does racing need more hero villains?
Yes.
Yes. It makes it interesting.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
I mean, right now you have. Kyle Busch,
yeah,
and the rest of the field. World of Outlaws, it used to be Sammy and Kinzer. Yeah. Now, I don't even think you could put shots in there, Mike. Ken, no.
No.
Well, in Charlotte, there were a lot of Brad Sweet fans, and they were loving life that he beat Donnie Shots. And it was great to see. I mean, but, yeah, there were a lot of there were a lot of negativity towards Donnie Shots.
But yeah, you get that heated rivalry. It's, you know, just like wrestling. Mm-hmm. It's going to bring the fans back, you know, mm-hmm. and pack the house because they want to see what's going to happen, you know.
It gives people something to talk about,
exactly,
too.
Yeah.
I mean, same thing with the late models. I mean,
yeah.
Everybody
yeah.
still hates Blomqvist and
yeah.
and now they're loving Brandon Shepard.
Yeah.
And they still like Josh Richards. So it's,
yeah. And for all as much as everybody hates them guys,
yeah.
when they show up at a racetrack,
oh, yeah.
you walk up to their t-shirt
yeah.
trailer,
oh, yeah,
you're
yeah.
standing in line.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
You know, there's a lot of people buying their stuff, too. Yeah. So
that's just respect, though.
Oh, yeah, know, yeah, yeah.
Knowing
yeah.
what they accomplished yeah. and everything.
But
I mean,
I don't see that in USAC, though. I don't see the villain and hero
no.
because everybody gets supported, I think, pretty
but
much
you know
equally.
What, though? With the speeds they go...
Yeah, but you used to have Dixon and Bettenhausen,
yeah.
and that used to be a big rivalry.
Yeah, yeah. You just don't see it now.
There is nothing
because you've got Tyler Courtney.
Well, it used to be Opperman and Weld
yeah.
back
yeah.
in the days here, yeah. and Paxton and yeah. Allen, and that was
Kaufman,
like, phew.
Yeah.
I kind of think now like with USAC, them guys race each other so much.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, when they're out in the Midwest, when they get going in the summer, they're 4, 5, 6 nights a week. Mm-hmm. You know, so they're racing each other all the time, so they don't have a lot of time to be pissed off at each other.
Yeah.
Okay, with that, you know, do you think USAC taking the mile tracks is hurting them or just taking away racing that fans used to like to see? They took away Springfield, and they're, it's like...
I love seeing the Silver Crown cars.
Yeah.
And on those big tracks, that's where they were, that's where they're made to run. Anything half mile or bigger, but I just, that's a shame. It's just a shame.
I kind of think it's a sign of the times too. Yeah, you know, it's them mile tracks, they were as much about tradition as they were about the racing itself.
Yeah. Well, back in the day, too, they were fairgrounds. They used to have fairs. So it was a spectacular event.
Springfield was always held during their fair.
Yeah. Exactly, yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, Reading even had the fair.
Yeah, with USAC, and that was the coldest day I ever spent at a race. The Easter Eve race at the Reading Fairgrounds, USAC, and the Modifieds. I think Gerhardt won the Modifieds. Dixon won the USAC. It was 26 degrees with a wind chill of about 17. We got a home viewer. Thank you for calling. How do we direct your question? Hello?
Hello. I have a question for your panel.
Go ahead.
Speaking of the villains and good guys, okay, if you take away the villains and the good guys, and then you take away the old fogies, does your sportsman and your slingshot guys have enough to take over when those guys leave?
So you're basically saying, are there enough small car drivers to take the place of the losing big car drivers?
Yes. So like when the three amigos, Von Dorn, Howard, and Strunk, when they finally decide to hang up their helmets, are we going to have anybody to step up into their place?
We have a lot of younger guys.
I think
we will.
I'm thinking is Loudon Reimert as well.
Yeah,
Loudon, Dylan.
Yeah.
Okay, but let's spread it other than just Grandview. If you know, how long can Alan Johnson and Danny Johnson and Brett Hearn's calling a career?
Yeah.
So what do we have? I mean, I know Rocky Bullwinkle Warner went crazy up in New York, but do we have people to take their place?
I think.
Fire away, Mike.
Okay. Me, everybody knows that I'm more small car than big car. Right now, I mean, I try to go to as many races as I can. But I'm going to speak just in our division. You know, you got your Heath Hanleys and your Mike Rutherfords, and you can go on and on and on. Super, super drivers, and they're getting up there in age. But the talent that's coming up, there's a lot of kids are going right from the quarter midgets into the lower class micros, one being Marty Bryan. I mean, well, both brothers, Cliff and Marty.
And that's Tyler Lindsay.
Just, yep. Oh, and then you go to 600, even the restricted, Logan Rumsey and Tyler Henry. And I mean, there's some talent coming. I mean, it's going to go further. I talked to their parents. And, I mean, they're already, they either got a sprint car in the garage, or, you know what I mean? So it's...
And a lot of them are just quick. I mean, look at Loudon Reimert, Dylan Swidehart, even Joey Vaccaro. He's been coming on good.
Yeah, I think once you get the Von Dorns and the Howards and the Strunks go down, and they finally say, you know what, we're done, we won enough, can't do this anymore, we're not competitive anymore, you're going to start seeing these younger guys. I think you're going to start, they're really stepping up. The sportsman class, besides Brad Brakebill, there is a lot of good.
You can hump 12 guys, right?
It's a very competitive sportsman field right now, so I think they're going to be fine. But then I'm looking at the dirt. I mean, once, now that Hearn's retiring, how old's Matt Shepard? How long's he going to go?
Well, you have Matt Williamson.
You got Matt Williamson, and you have... McLaughlin, you got Max McLaughlin.
Mahaney.
I think there's enough talent that's going to be able to take the modified division to the next, you know, 10, 15 years, but I don't know.
As long as the money's still around.
And then you look at the 410 division, I mean, with little Freddie.
Yeah.
And then in Outlaws, I mean, you got Logan, you got Jacob. So I think they're pretty well set.
I think there's a lot of younger talented drivers coming along, mm-hmm. that when those guys walk away, there's going to be people to fill those seats.
Yep. Oh yeah.
But I think with how expensive it is anymore, mm-hmm. I don't think you're going to see the longevity that some of these guys have anymore, and the amount of wins. I mean, someone like Pouchy or Hearn or someone like that with 600-700 wins, yeah, I think you're going to be hard pressed to see guys that anymore, because I don't think you're going to see guys racing a modified for 35 or 40 years, you know, or a sprint car for that long.
I think we'll be out of owners before we're out of
Plus,
they won't be able to do it for a living.
Yeah, you think back to Central PA sprint cars back in the 80s and 90s, you know, you had 15 guys there that were driving a race car for a living.
Yeah.
And there is big money owners behind them that just race. Yeah. I don't care what you do, just I want to win.
Yep.
Well, now you go up to the Grove on a Friday night, mm-hmm. and there's four or five guys that might do it for a living, mm-hmm. and about four or five owners that are saying, I'll spend the money, you just drive. The rest are cobbling things together and begging their sponsors for money, and yeah, it's not easy.
It's happening more and more to be able to field a good race team. Yeah. The teams combining.
Oh yeah, I mean,
it's a known thing in every division.
A lot of the big traveling teams, you know, the Outlaws and stuff. When you really start looking at who's involved, well, this guy gave him a truck and trailer because he owns a trucking company. Mm-hmm. This guy's paying for their motors for the year. This guy's paying for cars for the year. This guy's paying. Tires. You know, you got six different guys funneling money into that one team, where before you had one owner.
Yeah. Well, it's at a point now where a lot of race teams would sooner have the product sponsor than the money, because they know what they're getting. You know, if a guy's going to give me, you know, 150 gallons of motor oil, I don't have to go down to, you know, the store and get oil. And they sometimes know what they're getting.
Or a couple of cases of Coors Light.
When we ran go-karts, I was more happy with the product sponsors than getting the money.
Yeah, but then you look at the super teams like in the midget division with Clausen and Keith Coons.
Yeah. Fielding 8-9 cars, and they go to every race everywhere. You just boggles your mind how much money is actually funneling through there.
Well, you go out to PRI this weekend down in Indianapolis.
We were out there for a couple of years.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You walk around those aisles out there, and you see owners, drivers, mm-hmm. and crew chiefs. Mm-hmm. Yep. If you know who you're looking for, they're all there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's drag racing, it's off-road racing, it's sprint cars, it's modifieds, it's late models, it's asphalt, whatever. And that's what they're doing. They're going around to the booths, hey, I'll put your sticker on the side of the car, you can use my name in the advertisements, you can use my picture, but I want free stuff. I want Hymens, I want oil, I want and all that stuff saves the money. Though. Oh, yeah, big time.
Especially if you get the lightweight Hymens and the aluminums compared to, okay, here's a question, and I know what the answer is going to be, but why is it somebody like Kyle Larson can come to Grandview and the local tracks and is having 2,500 people watch him? You have 4,000 people watching. Is it name recognition? Is it the idea knowing that he's actually going back to his grassroots racing? What is it that Kyle Larson brings that attracts the people to the racetracks?
I think it is him coming back to his grassroots, and they all want to see how he can be able to race against these other guys in a division that he doesn't run all the time and still be able to beat them. And he does it.
Yep.
I mean, the kid is just that.
I'd like to see him getting a modified.
Funny story. Low Down and Dirty last week had Kyle Larson call in on their show. I had sent a question to Wimpy. I said, can we get him in a modified when he comes for the Thunder in the Hills show? And it now seems that Kyle Larson might be getting a ride Doug Van Miller's backup modified for the Thunder in the Hills show.
I didn't think the USAC show was going to be good at Kutztown just for the size. But he made the show.
He
made that.
Yep.
The kid can just drive. Yeah. There's just no two ways around
it. With that, do you think he has a stance saying that It all depends on what the owner is going to let him do outside of NASCAR, on how he signs his contract for in his upcoming years. I think he's got him by the you-know-what.
Yeah. And he had rumored that he would like to run the Indianapolis 500 one time in his career. Now, is that going to be put in with Chip? Is he going to let him do it? I don't know.
Chip's got enough cars to...
I would love to see him do it. I mean, I would love to see him get in any car and see what he can do with it.
Kurt Busch was fun to watch.
Oh, my God, yeah.
See, and another thing with that, like Tony Stewart broke his foot in a sprint car.
Yeah.
Now he made the chase. You know, now he can't run it. You know? So you have sponsors that dump a lot of money and that want to see their car on the racetrack. So
Yeah.
I think, though, he's one of them... He's like a generational driver. Mm-hmm. He's like, you know, when Stewart was in his prime, he could wheel anything. Yep. A.J. Foyt was the same way. Mario, you know, guys like that. And I think Larson, he's at the point in his career now, he's got a pile of money.
Mm-hmm.
He's got the name recognition. He's got the sponsors. Yeah, he wants to keep racing NASCAR, I think, because I think he has the Tony Stewart plan in mind. I'm going to pocket a bunch of money, and then I'm going to go have fun racing sprint cars. Yeah,
because he did say he would like to be the oldest World of Outlaw Rookie of the Year.
Yeah.
So how long is he planning on running in Cup yet before that happens? I don't know, but I would love to see it. And the thing is, between him and Tony, Joe Gibbs held Tony Stewart back, that he couldn't do everything.
Yeah.
Because I think it was just that kind of owner. Chip Ganassi, on the other hand, he goes to the races with Kyle.
Yeah.
And he was at the Knoxville Nationals with Kyle. He loves the dirt.
I think Kyle, he's as much of a fan as he is.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Kyle's wife might be more of a hero than him, since she shot in the air.
Okay, we're down 2 minutes. Race you want to see on your 2020 schedule, Mike?
Oh, man. The Silver Crown cars at Sealands Grove.
Okay.
Same.
Mine's got to be the wingless USAC at Grandview. I love the slide jobs, especially like where I'm at. I got one of the best seats in the house. So,
what's up with you, Mike?
I'll take my USAC midgets at Lanco.
Do they actually let them run all the way down at the bottom? Because when they have the classes there, they have the tires up. Are they allowed can the midgets run all the way down the bottom of the track?
I can't answer that. Okay. I mean, it's one of them deals where they do that to save the track.
And,
you know, but I know they can run the fence.
Okay. We saw that. On the fence, too. What about you, Eric?
Silver Crown show at Sealands Grove for sure. And I definitely want to get to a race at Port Royal. I
go to the modified race.
I want to, and that probably would be one or a super late model show there.
It's March 22nd. It'll be cold.
Yep.
I was there last year. It was a good race.
I think in October they
used to go back in the day with Larry Solomon and help
50,000 land there.
I've heard so many good things. All the improvements that they made at that place. I gotta go.
Well, I didn't get to Bedford this year due to my eye issues. So I already talked to Mrs. C and I told Joanne, be prepared for me to come out and take Gerald to Bedford. So Gerald Chamberlain and I are going to have a night at Bedford Speedway in the year 2020. So on behalf of Mike Fitzgerald, Scott Arndt, Jeff Grippley Evans, Mike Knappenberger, Eric Gambler, I'm Mike Feltenberger. Thank you and have a good evening.
The Strapped In Auto Racing Show on BCTV is supported by Shirley and Shelley Miller.